Downstairs, I'm gonna grab my
sure.
11, oh, about 6:30.
Wednesday at 5 o'clock. Soup and sandwich, Lenten services, Wednesday evening. Starting at 6, looks like the youth are preparing the meal this Wednesday. So if you look on the schedule, if you're wondering when you serve, Team 3 on the 15th, Men on the 22nd, Potluck on the 29th, and Team 2 on the 5th. Suggested 4 soups and 4 dozen sandwiches each week. Change it to 3? We have plenty. Okay. So it's suggested 3 soups, and is 3 dozen then too, Kate? That'd be alright. 3 soups and 3 dozen sandwiches. The plan. Wednesday night Lenten services starting at 6 to eat, 7 o'clock is service. Prayer breakfast at Grandma Sharon's, 8 o'clock Saturday morning. And then don't forget to set your clocks ahead 1 hour before you go to bed Saturday night. Sunday morning, 9:30 Sunday school, 11 o'clock worship. Reminder to the council that we will have council meeting next Sunday after service. Church council at around 12 o'clock noon. It'll be a short council meeting, so it shouldn't take long. Other events, again, we talked about Lent, Youth for Christ banquet coming up. As you can see there, the 6th of April, 6:30 at the well. Bill's got some tickets, as well as Pastor John, so if you want to go to the Youth for Christ banquet, talk to them. Bob Upker will be the speaker. If you're familiar with him, he's the chalk artist, if you've seen him before, so he's very good. Again, talk to Bill or Pastor John for the tickets. Youth for Christ banquet on the 6th of April at 6:30. Any other announcements before we move on? Yeah. No prayer breakfast this coming Saturday. No prayer breakfast at Grand Sharon's this weekend. Any other announcements? Changes? Have I forgotten? What time? WMF next Saturday, 10:30. You add that to your list. Is that here at the church? WMF here at the church next Saturday, 10:30. Any other announcements? Let's move on then and look at some of our prayer requests. We have plenty of them also. I ask you to be in prayer for all of these people. I mentioned especially Marla. Marla did have her surgery. It went very well. Be in prayer for her as she recovers. Brian mentioned this morning that they will start chemo probably around the end of the month for Marla. So, please be in prayer for her. Answer to prayer, Lenore. Biopsy went well, no cancer. No cancer, Lenore. So, an answer to prayer there, that's Doug's sister. Biopsy, no cancer. I'd also ask, if I could, for prayer for my grandson, Caleb. We've had him on our prayer list for quite some time. Ended up in the hospital on Friday. With what they're calling MAS, and it's not something that you'd be very aware of. It's very uncommon. It's actually the next step after rheumatoid arthritis. If they can't control it, then they get MAS. I can't explain it very well, but it's somehow or another that the cells start attacking the good cells also rather than just the bad. So he's 4 years old in hospital in Minot. Talked about transferring him to Children's Hospital in the cities and called their doctor and said there was a room at the Children's Hospital. So he's still in Minot. Last night they started an IV steroid. Normally he gets around 45, and to try and kick this, they gave him around a 450 of steroids. And I got a text from Jeremy this morning, and he said that they'll find out around noon if it's doing any good. If not, they're not, even the doctors aren't sure where they're going from here. So, I'd ask special prayers for Caleb and Jeremy. 4 years old, Jeremy said this morning that he was getting pretty hard to keep in bed and keep his IV in, fussy. So I appreciate your prayers for him. Others on our prayer list this morning, Brandon, with hernia disc, others, many others there, Lisa, pregnancy. Any other prayer requests that we need to add this morning? No? Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you today for your promises and the many things going on, Lord, in our lives, and those unspoken prayer requests that may be out there too this morning. We just ask that you would be with us in a special way this morning. Grant us your strength, your comfort. Those that are feeling ill, those in the hospital, those unspoken, we just ask for your strength and your comfort for each one this morning. As we're reminded, we thank you that this life is temporary. Sometimes we feel like the whole world is falling in on us. And we ask ourselves why. Lord, we just ask this morning that each one here would know and realize that this life is temporary, and one day you will come and all will disappear for us believers. And it will be wonderful and beautiful. We look for that day. And in the meantime, we ask for you to be with us, be with each one of us in a special way. Father, we thank you for Lenore's answer to prayer this morning. No cancer in her biopsy. How happy she must be. Be with her too in a special way. Thank you for each one here. Thank you, Lord, for communion today, that we may come to you, that we may have what you offer. Help each one of us to turn our heart toward you and to be ready for what you have for us. Be with Pastor John this morning as he brings us the word. May the words that he has for us come from you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this church, this family, and all of us that attend. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's turn then to hymn number 190. Oh, we were going to do, I didn't do call to worship, did I? Nobody hollered at me. My wife even. Call to worship. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him. Now we'll sing hymn number 194, One There Is Above All Others. 194. Let's stand this morning.
Taken on himself our nature, so that he might fulfill for us the whole will and the whole law of God, and for our deliverance suffer death and all that we because of our sins deserve, to the end that we should more confidently believe that Christ has done this for us, that we might be strengthened by our faith. Jesus instituted the sacrament of his supper, in which he feeds us with his body, in which he gives us to drink of his blood. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks of this cup firmly believing the words of Christ dwells in Christ, and Christ in him, and he has eternal life. We should also do this in remembrance of Jesus. We remember his death and how he was delivered for our sins and raised again for our justification. With grateful hearts, then we should respond to his gifts by taking up our crosses and following him, and by loving one another as he has commanded, even as he has loved us. For we are all one bread and one body, as we are partakers of this one bread and drink of this one cup. As we prepare to receive these gracious gifts of God, may we bow together before our Lord and confess our sins. Our most gracious Father in heaven, we bow before you to confess our sin and to seek your forgiveness. We have not esteemed others better than ourselves. We have fallen into sin because of our weakness. We know that sin leads to death, and your gift to us is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Strengthen our hearts against sin, and forgive us when we fail. Grant to us the promise of eternal life with you in heaven, and your grace to live here on this earth. In Jesus' name.
Chapter 3, it's called the Fall of Man. The first
first 21 verses, the long passage will remain seated, but know that this is an event that happened in history. It's a recording that God inspired Moses to write. It is the Word of God. Genesis 3, 1 through 21. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. Satan entered him, and through him he said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "You may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will surely not die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is it you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." To the woman, he said, "I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. With pain you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband. He will rule over you." To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you. You will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return." Adam named his wife Eve, because she would become the mother of all the living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife. We find the Apostle Paul inspired by God to write of this, the fall of mankind, your fall in mind that was in Adam, as well as the victory we have in Christ, and place them side by side for us in Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 9. "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men because all sinned. For before the law was given, sin was in the world. But sin is not taken into account when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as did Adam, who was the pattern of the one to come. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by grace through the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Again, The gift of God is not like the result of the one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation. The gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? Consequently, just as the result of one trespass was condemnation for all men, so also the result of one act of righteousness was justification that brings life for all men. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many were made righteous. Here ends the reading of our scripture.
My heart is beating like the word.
Thank you.
sing together, "Who Will Now Indict Me?" Number 414. Sinners. It's often been said, and rightly so, that we are not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. And Paul has made clear in Romans that Adam is sin. Because we're in Adam is also our sin, and we're found guilty even from the time of our conception. We read about that battle, and now we read about a new man, a man who was created perfectly and was put to the test by the same one, even Jesus. We're going to read about this test, this battle, in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. In respect for God's word, if you're able, please stand in respect for God's word. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and said to him, and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, It is also written, "Do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" Then the devil left him and angels came and attended him. Lord, I pray that in this text we would find the hope we've been looking for, and that in finding it we would never look elsewhere. Lord, work in us that are prone to wander from the truth you give us in your word might be stopped, that we might find perfect peace in the finished work, in the victory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Grant this, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Adam and Eve were tempted and fell, and that made us a sinful human race, gave us natures that are sinful. You who have raised children know you don't have to teach them how to sin. They already know how. That's their very nature, to produce sin. We need to teach them what sin is, that they might repent and turn away from sin and turn to God and ask forgiveness and ask for mercy. But because we sin, God's word says so clearly that death is our destiny. Not just physical death, as God told Adam and Eve in the garden, "To dust you will return," certainly. Temporal death will happen to all of us except the generation where Christ returns. In other words, our spirit will leave our body and our bodies will be put in the ground and they'll return to what they were made out of. They'll return to dust. But when God said on the day that you eat of the fruit of the tree I forbid you to eat from, you will surely die, he meant exactly what we see happen with Adam and Eve. We see that finally shame became part of their lives. Guilt became part of their lives. They knew they were guilty, and they were ashamed. They knew they couldn't stand in the presence of God, that his judgment rested on them. And we see the results of their sin right away as God calls them, and they strive by their own efforts to cover their shame, but are unsuccessful in doing so. We see Adam doing what all you guys do now. He blames his wife. And even worse, he blames God. He said, "This woman you gave me." And so we see that because of Adam and Eve's unwillingness to listen to the promise of God and instead to listen to the lies of Satan, they had joined Satan in a rebellion and now would flee from God and would hate God and live as those who were no longer in the state for which God created them to live, but we're in a state of rebellion against God, open rebellion, willful rebellion. Until one man came, we're told about that man in the book of Hebrews, that he was tempted in every way, even as you are, even as I am, even as we are, yet, unlike Adam and Eve, and unlike you and me, without sin. In the text we've read today from Matthew, we see the ultimate battle of all history. If you study history, you see it's full of wars, and you can read many details about many of the wars that have taken place. In the end, it doesn't matter who wins or loses any of those wars if this battle had been lost. Ultimately, all who were in Adam would have been destined to eternal death. And there would be no possibility of anything in all of creation or any effort by any individual to rescue mankind from that destiny. This is history's ultimate battle, the battle that determined whether or not there would be any hope for any of mankind. And thankfully, it's recorded for us. It's as important as what Jesus did on the cross. If we read chapter 3 before this, we'd see that this event took place right after Jesus was baptized. And it's interesting to note that after his baptism, the Holy Spirit descended on him in the form of a dove, and that the voice of God the Father, came from heaven and declared a fact. He said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And so we see, as the devil, after 40 days of testing in various ways, comes in a way that's very real and very personal, even as he appeared to Adam and Eve in the form of a serpent in the garden, now no longer in a garden, no longer in a place where all provision was present for mankind, but for this man now, after 40 days and 40 nights of not eating and being hungry with no provision around him, no garden, no trees, no fruit, now Satan comes. He heard what God had said to Jesus, "You are my Son." And he begins, "If you are the Son of God," questioning again, even as he did with Adam and Eve. Did God really say in the garden, "If you are the Son of God," testing the Word of God, testing to see whether Jesus would trust in God's Word, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." History's ultimate battle is one where a new mankind can begin. There is mankind, all of whom are found in Adam. Now the opportunity for a part of the human race, or all of the human race, should everyone come to faith in Christ, have the opportunity to be found no longer in Adam, but in Christ. If Christ would win the victory, then carrying that victory, even as mankind by nature and by birth are carrying the nature of Adam. History's ultimate battle. If it's lost, no hope. If it's won, there's hope of being part of a new history. One that's eternal. One that restores a relationship with God. So what's tested in this battle? First and foremost, it's a battle for trust. Adam and Eve were provided everything by God, everything they needed. They were perfectly happy and perfectly content in the garden that God had placed them in. They were given beauty around them unlike any that has been seen since the fall. They were given abundant food. They were given fellowship with each other. They were given the opportunity to produce more human beings and to raise them to know God. They were lacking nothing as a created being. They were given everything that that created being was intended to have by God. And in the midst of all of that abundance, what was tested was whether they trusted God. God had made only one stipulation. He'd only withheld one thing from them. And that was the fruit of a tree in the middle of the garden called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God had withheld from them the knowledge of good and evil. Had he withheld it from them because he wanted to gypped them from some pleasure that they could have by knowing it? And the answer to that question is none at all. Let me just ask you, have you enjoyed now knowing evil? Is it a blessing to you to know evil? When you read your newspapers and watch your televisions today, are you glad to see what's taking place because now you know good from evil? When God withholds things, it's for the purpose of blessing. And God withheld that from Adam and Eve, and Satan came into the garden and lied and said, "God is withholding something good from you, some wisdom." And Eve believed no longer the word of God, but the word of Satan, and Adam was right there. We're told in our lesson from Genesis, Adam was there with Eve, watching all this take place. And when Satan said, "God's withholding something good from you, the knowledge of good and evil, you'll be like God in the way that you'll know good and evil," she listened to Satan. Her trust in her heavenly Father, who had been so good to her, was tested, and she no longer trusted her Father, but trusted the word of Satan. And she willfully rebelled against God and ate. I suspect that Adam was watching all this going on, wondering, I wonder what's going to happen to her. God said, "You'd surely die." And she took a bite. We'd say it was the apple. We don't have any idea what kind of fruit it was. I think it was a pomegranate. anyway. She takes a bite, and Adam watches, and nothing happens. That was good, Adam. Here, you try it. Nothing happened to her. Maybe God's word wasn't right. Maybe what Satan promised was. He takes a bite. And the eyes of both of them were open. And for the first time ever in the history of mankind, which was brief at this point, there was shame and there was guilt. Guilt has been eating people up from the inside out ever since. The result of this rebellion against God is evident in every page of history. Jesus' trust was tested then too. I heard the Father say, "You're the Son of God. If you're the Son of God, prove it. Turn these stones into bread. After all, you're hungry." And Jesus is put in the same position as Adam and Eve. Will you trust your Heavenly Father to provide all that you need? It's almost as though Satan was saying, "Your Father led you out here into the desert. Your Father is the one who guided you to not eat for these last 40 days and nights. It's because of your Father you're hungry now. It's his fault. Don't trust him. I mean, after all, you have the power to turn these stones into bread. Go ahead and do it and satisfy your hunger. Trust me, it'll feel good to eat that bread." And it's interesting to see Jesus' answer. It isn't just, "By my authority I say, I'm not going to do what you tell me to do," but instead he goes to the word that had already been recorded, and he relies on it. The promises of God that have been recorded. He goes to the scriptures. It is written, "Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Deuteronomy 8, verse 3. Physical nourishment is not all man needs. It's the word of God that created man. It's the word of God that sustains man. It's the word of God that calls man back to relationship with him. It's the word of God on which we have true life, life that can't be taken away. And we see Jesus winning this battle by trusting not what Satan says, but by what the word of God says. Trusting the word of God. And it's interesting to see then that that's followed immediately by the devil taking Jesus to the holy city, setting him up on the pinnacle of the temple with a fall, a long fall down below with rocks to land on. Satan is clever. He says, "If you are the Son of God," again, he begins with that. You need to prove it again. And you've shown that you rely on the promises of God, not prove that you rely on the promises of God. Throw yourself down because the word of God says, "He will command his angels concerning you. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone." You trust in God, then his word promises protection. Throw yourself down and let him prove he will protect you. Psalm 91. 11 and 12. Isn't that interesting? That when we trust in the word of God, Satan is very good at quoting the word of God. You know, we might look at this and say, "Well, Jesus found another quote that supersedes this." It's not the case at all. Jesus simply places scripture beside scripture. That's important for us to do. Jesus knew the word of God. When verses are taken out of context, they can be made to mean pretty much what anyone wants them to mean. We need to be aware of that because Satan has many minions today that are declaring, quote, truths, unquote, from God's word. They're quoting directly God's word, but they're taking it out of context and making it tell us something that it doesn't say. So Jesus is able, with his knowledge of God's word and his understanding of the promises of God, to place scripture beside scripture so that the scripture that Satan quotes can be seen for what it really says. It says simply that God will take care of you. The problem with the way Satan was quoting it is that it would give us an attitude that would say, "God, I'm wondering about your word. I'm going to put your word to the test to see whether you really would do what you say," instead of saying, I humbly trust your word even in tough circumstances. Jesus quotes from Deuteronomy 6:16, a passage where the people of Israel had tested God because of their lack of water. Instead of relying on God quietly in prayer, humbly looking to him for help, they shook their fist in God's face and said, "Prove you're a God who keeps his promises." They were presumptuous and proud. That's what Jesus was being tempted to do. The presumption and pride to test the word of God. "I don't believe your word, God, so I'm going to put it to the test." Jesus answers from Deuteronomy 6:16, and he says, "It is also written, do not put the word of your God to the test." By the way, when we read this account, we're reading what actually happened. Jesus was actually physically taken to the pinnacle of the temple, and now we're told Satan takes him physically to a high mountain. If we'd have been there in that day, we would have seen him in the various places Satan took him. The devil took him to a very high mountain. He showed him in some way that we can't understand all the kingdoms of this world and their splendor. He showed them not only the kingdoms, but their greatness, their splendor. A lot of people like to travel the world and see the beautiful buildings, the palaces, and the riches that have been accumulated by men. That's what Satan showed Jesus, and he said, "All this I will give you if you bow down and worship me." Satan talked as though he had it to give. Satan certainly is called the prince of the power of the air. He's certainly called a prince of this world. But he doesn't rule because he's been given the right to rule. It's because he's usurped authority from the one who's truly in charge, the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And his rule can only accomplish the will of God. God uses even what Satan does to bless those who love God and are called according to his purpose. If Jesus would have responded, said, "Okay, God, the Father has promised me the kingdoms of this world, and now I can receive them through you simply by bowing down, I'll do that," had Jesus done that, there'd be no hope in all of history. But Jesus does not do that. For the first time in this account, we see Jesus speak his own command apart from the word of God. He begins by saying, "Away from me, Satan. Get away." But then he also goes to the word of God. He says, "For it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Deuteronomy 6:13, Deuteronomy 10:20. Jesus, we might say, sets us a good example for when we're tempted. And while we're tempted not only from Satan on the outside and his demons, we're also tempted by our own lusts and desires that are out of whack with the way God created us because we're fallen creatures. We might look at this and say, now I get the secret. I can win over temptation by understanding the word of God, trusting in it, and quoting it back to Satan. Good idea, it really is. When we're tempted to trust the promises of God's word and respond to Satan and to our own desires with the word of God is a good idea. Go ahead and try it. Even in doing that, have you failed? I have. The wonderful news we have from Jesus' victory is that by the grace of God, his victory is my victory. His victory is ours. I'm so grateful for what Paul told us in Romans. He says that in Adam, all are under judgment. All are under sin. All are under the sentence of death. In Adam, and we're all in Adam, we're all descendants of his, we're all lost. But he tells us that in Christ, we're all made alive. That the victory Christ won, this battle that he fought, tempted in every way, even as we are yet without sin, he won on our behalf. That there is a righteousness with which we can stand before God. And it isn't the one we produce. Mind you, once it's given to us, we strive to produce it. We long to produce it. Our hearts change and we want to be pleasing to God. We don't want to do what's right to try to earn anything anymore. But out of love for God, we begin to do what's right. But we find that our own nature's still there, keeping us from doing any of it perfectly ever. We could be lost in total despair if we were to look only at ourselves and the righteousness we produce. The fact is, we're shown the battle Jesus fought. The fact that before this battle, God said with him, I am well pleased, and after this battle, God the Father still says with him, I am well pleased. Jesus was tempted in every way, even as we are, yet without sin. His righteousness is his gift to you and to me. Because we earn it? Because we deserve it? No. Because somehow or other I become a better person that has done some special trick or prayed some special prayer that makes it mine? But because his word comes to each and every one of us and says to us, Jesus did this for you. That's what the Lord's Supper said. Jesus says, this is my body given for you. This is my blood shed for you. Take, eat, drink of it, all of you. It's here to assure us that what Jesus did is ours. And if we come without believing that, if we come without understanding that we're a sinner in need of this victory, we're eating God's judgment on ourselves. But if we come understanding that there's no hope of victory in what I do, and I need Jesus' certain victory, and that while I don't deserve it, he gives it to me, then we can be assured that Jesus' victory is ours. Believing, then, the word of God, not believing the lies surrounding the circumstances of our lives, not believing the lies of Satan, not trusting in me and my own wisdom, but trusting in the promises of God connected with Christ, I find myself in Christ, and he in me. And I find that I have forgiveness of sins, adoption into the family of God, and eternal life now and forevermore. Tempted in every way, he won. His victory is for you and for me and him. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for sending us a Savior, for sending one who did all that we have failed to do, for doing what Adam and Eve failed to do, for doing what the nation of Israel failed to do, for doing what we have failed to do, for being tempted in every way, for being called by Satan to not trust you, but to trust himself, to trust the lies of Satan, to rebel against you in order to find fulfillment in self, Lord. He was tempted in every way, even as we are, and yet always remained one who trusts in you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that his perfect obedience is your gift to us. Pray that you'd assure us of that gift now as we come to receive the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup. When he had supped and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Come. Thank you. Nancy over here, and I thought, who's that? He's so looking for assistance. We'll turn together in our hymnals to 276. We'll sing, "O Jesus, Blessed One," to thee. Forever and ever. Amen.